Hello friends, in the last lecture we learned about Mauryan Empire. In this lecture we will see what was going on in South India when the Northern Territory was ruled by Mauryan rulers. So first we will start with the background of South India. Around 1000 BC there was Iron Age in South India and the culture of that time was known as Megalithic culture. This culture is named based on funerary practice, and as there was no other historical source available for this culture, so only the grave or megalithic stone is evidence of this culture, so we called this culture as Megalithic culture. And this Megalithic culture is found around not only in India but also in other country. And in Northeast India there was also Megalithic culture, but in this lecture we will learn only about Megalithic culture of South India. The grave were encircled by large pieces of stone, and in the grave goods like pottery, hunting and fishing tools were also buried with the dead people. The vertical monolithic pillar on grave is known as Menhir. Here are the two images to show the Megalithic culture. In the first image you can see the grave was encircled by a number of stones. In the second figure you can see large stones are erected on the grave. So there was different method of erecting stone on grave, and all these are part of Megalithic culture. In 1000 BC, South Indian people used to live on the slope of hill instead of plain. Although at that time they produced paddy and ragi, the production was very low and in a limited area. And at that time, the dead were buried with objects, mainly fighting tools and large size of stone were placed around it, around the grave. It was the Jain Buddhist and Brahmin missionaries who spread materialistic culture in the south. The cultural and economic contact between North and South India are known as Tamij Hakam, and this cultural and economic contact gave rise to state formation in South India. So over the time, three important states formed in South India around 300 BC. In 300 BC, around 3rd century BC, Megasthenes was aware of Pandyan kingdom and pearl stone of Pandya. Asoka Rog 13 also mentioned about southern kingdom, Chola, Kerlaputra, Pandya, Satyaputra and Tamrapanis. Tamrapanis were people of Sri Lanka. Hathigumpha inscription of King Kharvel also mentioned about Tamil Southern Kingdom. In this inscription, the King Kharvel mentioned that the Tamil country and how King Kharvel destroyed the confederacy of Tamil states. So in the South India, when the North India was ruled by Ashoka, the Southern India was ruled by three important kingdoms, Chol, Chera and Pandya. So the Chola kingdom was, the Chola ruler ruled over modern day location of Northern Tamil Nadu. Chera ruled over the Kerala and southwest Tamil Nadu region, and Pandyan ruled over southern Tamil Nadu region. The capital of Chola kingdom was Urayur or Puhar or Kaveripatnam. The capital of Chera kingdom was Vanji or Karur. The capital of Pandya kingdom was Madurai. Each kingdom has their own state symbol that was depicted on their flags. The Chola has state symbol of tiger, The Chera has state symbol of bow and arrow, and Pandya has state symbol of fish. The important city of Chol Chera and Pandya kingdom is shown in the figure below. So the red dot shows the important cities of Chola, important cities of Chola kingdom. The black dot shows important city of Pandya kingdom, and the green dot shows important city of Chera kingdom. So in the figure you can see the Urayur, capital city of Chola, and important port city of Chola Empire is Kaveripatnam and Arikamedu, and another important port city was Marakkaram above Arikamedu. The important city of Pandya kingdom was Madurai, their capital, and port city of Korkai. The important cities of Chera kingdom was Vanji or Karur, which was their capital, and three important port city Panthar, Mujris, and Tondi. So we will see each kingdom in some detail in this slide. So Chola kingdom, they ruled over the northern Tamil Nadu. Their capital was at Urayur on the bank of Kaveri River. The Urayur was famous center for the cotton cloth, and the cloth were exported to Roman Empire. Northern ruler, the southern ruler also took different title, like Ashoka took the title of Devanampiyadasi, and a king took title of Vikramaditya. So southern kings also took some title, but it was not so important. If you want to read, you can read. The Chola king took the title of Senani, Valavan, and Kili. Around 1000 BC, King Alar of Chola kingdom conquered Sri Lanka and enslaved many Sri Lankan. Famous Chola king Karikal of 2nd century AD built embankment on Kaveri River with the help of Sri Lankan slave. He founded the Puhar city or Kaveripatnam. And after founding the Kaveripatnam city, he changed capital from Urayur to Kaveripatnam. Pattimpalai, a book by Kadiyalur, depicts the military achievement of King Karikal. In the Battle of Venni, King Karikal defeated Chera, Pandya, and other small rulers. Port city of Chola kingdom was Puhar, Kaveripatnam, Arikamedu or Marak, and Marakkanam. Chera ruler. Chera ruled over the modern day territory of Kerala plus southwest Tamil Nadu. The capital of Chera kingdom was at Vanji, Karur, on the bank of Amravati River. Pugalur inscription of 1st century AD has reference of three generations of Chera rulers. The Chera rulers took title of Vanavaramban, Vanavan, Kuttuvan, Irumpuroi, Vilavar. Famous Chera ruler Senguttuvan of 2nd century AD introduced the Patini cult or worship of Kannagi. It was worshipping the wife for her dedication. I will explain it when we will study the Sangam literature, especially Silpadikaran. The Senguttuvan was the first South Indian king to send ambassador to China. His military achievement have been recorded in the epic Silpadikraman. In the Silpadikraman epic, it was mentioned that he took expedition to Himalaya and he fought with the northern rulers. Roman people built temple of King Augustus in Chera kingdom port city Mujris. So in port city Mujris, there was a temple of King Augusta, and it was built by Roman people. And Roman people also set up two regiments at Mujeres port. So they used to do a lot of trade with Southern Kingdom. So they set up regiments. They also built their temple in the Chera Kingdom in the Mujeres city. Port city of Chera Kingdom are Pantar, Mujeres and Tondi. Pandya Kingdom. They ruled over southern Tamil Nadu. Their capital was at Madurai on the bank of Vagai River. The kingdom was famous for pearls. The Pandya king took title of Thenavar or Minavar. Mangulam cave inscription by King Nedu. Mangulam cave inscription by King Nedun Chelian I was considered as the earliest Tamil inscription in Brahmi script. Pandyan ruler was responsible for Kovalan execution for which Kannagi burned Madurai. This was also related to Silpadikraman book or epic of Tamil literature, Silpadikraman. The Pandyan king organized three Sangam, and this Sangam is also known as Muchangam. They organized the three Sangam between 3rd century BC to 3rd century AD. Madurai Kanji by Mangudi Marunthankar depict the socio-economic status of Pandya nation. Kiladi nearby Madurai, Kiladi location nearby Madurai, at this location Roman artifacts and a rectangular ivory dice was found in 2022 excavation. And at Adi Channalur near Korkai, burial urns with Tamil Brahmi script was found. At Porunthal, paddy grain import with Tamil Brahmi inscription was found, and it was of 5th century AD. So many scholars suggest there was writing system in India before modern time, but we have Rig Veda of which was written around 1000 BC. It was not 5th century AD, but it was 5th century BC. So existence of writing system in India before modern time. But we have Rig Veda which was written around 1000 BC. So obviously we have writing system in India before modern time. We have writing system from Rig Vedas or Vedic time. And Pandyan king sent ambassador to Roman Emperor Augustus. The port cities of Pandya king was Korkai and it was on the bank on the river Tamprapararani. The power of this Sangam dynasty declined with the invasion of Kalabhars tribe, and they ruled from 300 to 600 AD in the South India, and at that time no literature or something historical evidence was found. So this period is known as Dark Age of South India. The administration of Southern Kingdom. The monarchy was hereditary. The king was known as Ko Manaman Mannam Vendan Koravan or Iraivan. Important officials of the kingdom were Amaichar or minister, Purohit priest, Dutar envoy, Senapati or commander, and Urad spies. कैप्टन ऑफ आर्मी वॉज नोन एज एनाडी. द किंगडम वॉज डिवाइडेड इंटू मंडलम और नाडू. टाउन वे आर नोन एज उर एंड विलेज वे आर नोन एज पेरूर एंड सिरूर. बिग विलेज वे आर नोन एज पेरूर एंड स्मॉल विलेज वे आर नोन एज सिरूर. करई वॉज द लैंड टैक्स इम्पोज एट द टाइम ऑफ संगमेज. एंड इराई वॉज ट्रिब्यूट पेड बाई फ्यूडिट्रीज एंड बूटी कलेक्टेड इन वॉर. Ulgu was custom duty. Irahu was extra demand or force gift. Varyam was a well-known unity of unit of territory yielding tax. Variyar was tax collector. Kavalmaram or Kadimaram. It was practice of planting a big tree at the king place, and that tree was symbol of power of the king. A big tree at the king palace was symbol of power, and this tree was known as Kavalmaram or Kadimaram. Virakkal or Nadukal. It was rising of hero stone on the grave of the brave dead soldiers. Was the economy of southern kingdom. So agriculture was their chief occupation. Rice was most common crop. There was tank land and it was known as aripati for irrigation or drinking water purpose. Discovery of monsoon wind by Hippalus around 45 AD further promoted trade between India and West. Marketplace was known as Angadi or Avnam. They used to trade with Greek, Egypt, Arabia and China. They used to trade among themselves and also used to do foreign trade with Greek, Egypt, Arabia and China. And they used to export items like spices, ivory, pearl, precious stone, silk and cotton clothes. And they used to import gold, glass, horse and wine. Many gold and silver coins of Roman emperor were found in the early southern kingdoms. So strong trade relation with foreign countries, especially Rome. So Sangam age, between 3rd century BC to 3rd century AD, the three Sangam or Muchangam was organized under the patronage of Pandya king, and this led to the rise of Tamil language, especially by Agathiya or Agastya Rishi. The first Sangam was held at Madurai and no literature survived of first Sangam. Second Sangam held at Kapatpuram and only Tolkappiyam survived from second Sangam. The third Sangam held at Madurai and in the third Sangam didactic and narrative poems were compiled. In the first and second Sangam mainly the work was done mainly on Tamil grammar, and in third Sangam the work was done on Tamil poems. Agathiyam was written by Agathiya or Rishi Agastya, and it was the oldest Tamil grammar book compiled in first Sangam, but it did not survive today. Tolkappiyam by Tolkappiyar. It was the oldest surviving Tamil grammar book compiled in second Sangam, and although it was Tamil grammar book, but it also described the political and socio-economic conditions of Sangam age. And Tolkappiyar was a disciple of Rishi Agastya or Agathiyar. The literatures of third Sangam is basically anthologies or collection of poem, and it was divided into two major parts. One is narrative, another one is didactic. The narrative one is 18 major work, also known as Melkanakku. And these 18 major work is further divided into two parts. One is 8 anthologies collectively known as Etuttevai, or and the second one is 10 idylls, or and these 10 idylls are known as Pattu Pattu. The didactive anthologies are 18 minor work, also known as Kilkanakku. And among these 18 minor works, the most important one is Tirukkural, and it was written by Tiruvalluvar. It is known as the fifth Veda from south, and also known as Bible of Tamil. Idylls were the poem where everything is perfect, the empire is happy, and there is no sadness. And regarding narrative work or Melkanakku, the theme was Puram and Aham. Puram represent valore, Aham represent love or emotion. So Melkanakku have two important theme, one is Puram and another one is Aham. And in didactive work or Kilkanakku, the narrative one was for narrative work is related to the story of some king or narration, someone do something extraordinary. But the didactive one is related to code of conduct, how the society should live in the Sangam age, what should be the code of conduct to be followed by an individual in the Sangam age. It was didactive one. Post-Sangam epics. There are five important epics that were written post-Sangam age, but it gives information about Sangam age. The first one is Silpadikaram by Elangu Adhikal. It is love story of a merchant named Kovalan and Madhvi. Kovalan was a merchant and Madhvi was courtesan. Kovalan was falsely accused of theft from the court of Pandya king, and Pandya king sentenced him to death. After the death of Kovalan, his wife Kannagi destroyed the whole city of Madurai. So the wife of Kovalan, Kannagi, stood for the justice of his husband, and that's why in South India, the worship of wife started by Sengattu, and it was known as Patni cult or worship of Kannagi. Another important epic of post Sangam age is Mani Meklai by Sattanar. It was sequel of Silpadikaram, and it describes story of daughter of Kovalan and Madhvi. Other epics of post Sangam age was Sivaka Chintamani, Valayapathi, Kundala Keshi. So the Sangam age literature give details of society of Sangam age. So religion was local religion plus Vedic religion. And the chief deity that the Sangam people used to follow was Murugan or Subramanya or Kartike, Lord Kartike. Other deity that was followed by Sangam people was Mayan or Vishnu, Vendan, Indiran, Varunan and Koravi. In the Sangam age, the condition of women were good. Women were allowed to select their husband, but the condition of widows was bad. The sati system was also there. Many women poets like Avaiyar, Nachachaliyar and Kakki Padiniyar contributed to Tamil literatures, and women's bravery was also lauded in some prayers. The social division. There was four social division given by Tolkappiya in his book Tolkappiyam, which was primarily Tamil grammar book but also give other information. So Tolkappiya mentioned about four division like Rigveda. In Rigveda we have Brahman, Kshatri, Shudra and Vaisya. So in the same manner Tolkappiya mentioned four division in the Sangam society, that is Anthanar known as priest, Arsar known as ruling class, king and other administrator, Manigar were traders and dealers, and Belalar then who were farmers. But after the second Sangam age, the other literature mention about few more division, like they probably it was subclass of Velalar. So Velalar were mentioned as rich peasant or rich farmers. Periyar was agriculture labor, you can call them as landless labor or landless farmer. And Kadasiyar was lower class of Sangam age. But Tolkappiya mentioned about only four division. The land was divided into five different type by Tolkappiya in his book Tolkappiyam. The hill area is mentioned as Kurunji, coastal area as Nedyal, and desert area as Palai, and the plain area is mentioned as Marudam for agriculture plain area and Mullai for pastoral plain area. So this is all about Sangam age. I will end my lecture here. Thank you.